Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents What a Unicorn Knows, How Leading Entrepreneurs Use Lean Principles to Drive Sustainable Growth, by Matthew E. May and Pablo Dominguez. Foreword by Nick Mehta. Narrated by Lyle Blaker. Foreword. The first time I met Matt May in person, I walked into a workshop where he was having all of my top executives play with toy cars. Immediately, I knew I loved this guy. Pablo Dominguez and I had been friends and partners for years, most recently with Insight Partners as an investor in my company, Gainsight. I knew there was no one savvier about scaling go-to-market functions than Pablo. So when he introduced me to Matt, I was excited to dig in. A couple days of off-site work learning how lean continuous process optimization works, plus several bungled toy car manufacturing facilities later, we walked away with four solid experiments that began our transformation. At Gainsight, we have seen the scale framework that Pablo and Matt created up close. Indeed, that framework has helped us re-accelerate our company growth over the last 3 years. Strategic speed was the only way we could work, so our culture fit well with the framework. Constant experimentation allowed us to get out of meeting analysis paralysis and start trying some things. Accelerated value tied so closely to the DNA of our company, which is all about customer success. Lean process was new to us, but fit perfectly with our goal of helping our clients accelerate time to value, which is a critical measure for every software as a service company. And esprit de corps was music to our ears, since we are a very values-driven company. A year after that first toy car workshop, we had increased our sales growth rate while reducing time to value for our clients by 66%. While anyone running a company knows that valuations like the unicorn stage are just a step in a journey, if you want to move faster on the road to building a great business, this book is for you. Nick Mehta, CEO, Gainsight. Introduction. Now I will believe that there are unicorns. William Shakespeare. During a senior leadership team meeting at the Palo Alto headquarters of venture-backed subscription software company Gainsight in late autumn of 2019, CEO Nick Mehta and then Chief Customer Officer Ashvin Vajanathan set two strategic goals for the coming year. First, they wanted to cut in half the business-to-business sales cycle, from initial customer quote to contract close, from 80 days to just 40. Second, they wanted to reduce the time it took for a newly signed customer to be onboarded and achieve a desired business outcome, a critical measure called time to value in the software as a service, or SaaS, world, with the Gainsight product going from 13 weeks to just 5. The big question was, of course, how? Internal capabilities and operating methods were simply not up to the task, at least not yet. Truth be told, the company was growing at such a furious pace that operational controls and disciplines had struggled to keep up. But some key customers weren't so happy, and for a company that was in the business of customer success, that wasn't ideal. The irony of the situation wasn't lost on the senior leaders. Launched 10 years earlier to help enterprise software companies better manage their customer relationships, Gainsight was well known for its customer success platform. Both Mehta and Vajanathan had authored popular books on how to leverage customer intelligence and build internal capability to improve client retention, reduce account churn, and identify new and more profitable revenue growth opportunities. Gainsight was approaching the $100 million mark in annual recurring revenue and was poised to take growth to the next level. Mehta and Vajanathan sought the outside counsel of equity investor Insight Partners, where we sit as operating specialists in the Sales and Customer Success Center of Excellence within the Insight On-Site Advisory Unit, on possible ways to approach their objectives. We suggested a process optimization methodology based on Toyota Production System's lean principles. We were confident that our approach would work, because we had developed a solid track record of accomplishing daunting goals, like those of Gainsight, in a manner faster, better, smarter, and cheaper than more traditional approaches to performance improvement with software technology companies. After a few short logistical meetings, we arrived at a challenging statement of work. 1. Select 24 professionals from across the Gainsight organization with integral frontline experience with the sales and customer onboarding processes. Train them on a powerful methodology for operational improvement, and also point that methodology toward dramatically shrinking the sales cycle and time to value. 2. Emerge with a portfolio of well-thought-through concepts, complete with experimental plans for proving them quickly without disrupting ongoing operations, and do so without any additional capital expense or new personnel. 3. Do all of that in less than 2 days. Given that one of Gainsight's stated core values is Shoshin, roughly translated from Japanese as beginner's mind, the Gainsight team was game for trying a new approach. Following a half-day immersive training exercise devoted to an experiential simulation, enabling both the leaders and the selected teams to create some esprit de corps and gain an intrinsic understanding of a lean system in action, namely the vaunted Toyota production system, the real work began. We formed 4 teams, 2 focused on the sales process, 2 on the post-sale process. Over the course of 6 intense hours the following day, we guided the teams through our lean framework, arriving at unique experiments the teams believed would yield proof of concept for their proposed solutions. Each team pitched their concept in a short, Shark Tank-like presentation to a board of senior Gainsight leaders, including Mehta and Vadyanathan. The sales process optimization countermeasures focused on improving mechanisms to better understand and align with customers on their desired business outcomes much earlier in the sales motion. This would eventually lead to more standardized offerings and reduced waste associated with unnecessary customization. Post-sale improvements included templated configuration wizards and phased implementations, involving a series of soft launches and go-live rollouts versus one big bang, resulting in earlier value delivery. Because the proposed solutions were universally perceived as having real impact, and since we had delivered on the statement of work, the senior leadership board granted approval to proceed with the experiments. Fast and frugal proof of concept tests were successfully carried out during the first quarter of 2020, with both targets being exceeded, followed by a company-wide rollout that set new sales cycle and onboarding records. In November 2020, just shy of 1 year from the initial gathering of Gainsight teams to learn and implement our lean-based methodology, Gainsight was acquired for a reported $1.1 billion, and so became a card-carrying member of the business club known as Unicorns. Rise of the Unicorn Class. On the morning of Saturday, November 2nd, 2013, Cowboy Ventures founder Aileen Lee posted an article on TechCrunch.com entitled, "Welcome to the Unicorn Club, Learning from Billion-Dollar Startups." Most people recognize a unicorn as the magical horned horse popularized in European folklore, fabled to be rare but real and never seen. But Lee coined a new meaning of the word unicorn, and that meaning stuck. "Many entrepreneurs and the venture investors who back them seek to build billion-dollar companies," she wrote. "So we wondered, how likely is it for a startup to achieve a billion-dollar valuation?" She defined unicorns as U.S.-based software companies started since 2003 and valued at over $1 billion by public or private market investors. At the time, unicorns by this definition were indeed as rare and magical as their mythical namesake. Less than 40 in existence, yielding an average of only 4 per year and representing less than 1% of startups. Much has changed in the decades since Aileen Lee's article. "We have become a subscription-based, technology-as-a-service economy, with dozens more unicorns born each year. In a COVID-influenced technology startup feeding frenzy among leading investors, 2021 saw nearly 600 new unicorns crowned, bringing the atmospheric total to well over 1,000 by year-end. The side effects of global geopolitical conflict emerged early in 2022, eventually contributing to a more modest birth rate for new unicorns. Still, it's safe to say that unicorns are no longer as rare and mythical as they were in 2003. In fact, it may not be too long before we will be talking about the Unicorn 500 in the same breath as the Fortune 500. Rapidly growing startups that have found what is commonly referred to as product market fit and a viable business model now find themselves facing an inflection point that signals an even more daunting stage of maturity, that of scale-up. A scale-up is a more mature, yet still adolescent company, generally characterized by rapid annual growth of over 20% for at least 3 years. Scale-ups, and those that invest in them, face the next level challenge of growing revenue at scale, that is, exponentially relative to expenditures in capital, people, and technology. Where startups search for product, market fit, and consistency in customer retention, scale-ups search for scalable product market fit or go-to-market fit. Many business leaders believe scale-up to be the most difficult phase of a company's life cycle, requiring the most help, support, and guidance on the development of specific disciplines to ensure that the business does not crumble under its own weight. And it is precisely this stage in which many scale-ups, giddy from growth, get ahead of themselves, stumble, and fail. Jeff Horing, co-founder and managing director of private equity and venture capital firm Gainsight Partners, believes that the task of scaling up a rapidly growing technology company is so difficult and complex that it may require two CEOs. According to a recent report published by Wakefield Research, startups need to graduate to scale up. To enter this phase, companies must demonstrate that they are robust, with the ability to survive unique challenges not faced by startups or mature legacy companies. Specialized resources and education are needed to address these impediments and ensure that scale-ups are empowered throughout their journey. Sharing some of those specialized resources and education are the focus of this book. Our aim is to help answer the central question: why do some young companies become unicorns while others don't? The Wakefield Research quote gives a hint. It's not the technology. It's the impediments, the obstacles, and the forces of resistance all working against them as they attempt to scale, grow, and build a sustainable, competitive position. This book is meant to help you minimize those opposing forces by drawing on a framework of battle-tested, lean-based, tool-supported operating principles. Employing these principles and practices will help startups become scale-ups. Scale-ups become unicorns. Unicorns become grown-ups, $1 billion plus in revenue, 1,000 plus employees, and grown-ups recapture the spirit and growth curve of a unicorn. The physics of sustainable growth. If a picture is worth 1,000 words, then a metaphor is worth 1,000 pictures. We like to think of a company in the throes of scaling up as a vehicle for rapid yet sustainable growth whose movement is like that of a Formula One race car. Both have amazingly advanced technology. Both need speed, acceleration, aerodynamic efficiency, and maneuverability to succeed. Competition aside, both face opposing physical forces that must be overcome to win. These naturally occurring forces have business corollaries that can determine whether or not a company realizes its long-term potential. Four primary forces work against any object in motion, including a rapidly growing company: drag, inertia, friction, and waste. Drag. Drag is the resistance of air against a moving object. Drag in the business context often manifests itself at the strategic level and can be experienced by such adverse indicators as sluggish market moves, inability to change direction with agility, and company-wide misalignment of strategies and objectives. Companies vulnerable to drag lack clarity on exactly where and how to dominate specific spaces and segments to grow beyond their initial product market success. And even in companies that do not lack this clarity, there is a general lack of alignment down and across all operations and functions. Many don't have a sound method to synchronize strategies, initiatives, and objectives, which in turn makes it nearly impossible for supporting levels of the company to know precisely what matters most or where to focus. In these conditions, everything slows down, not the least of which is decision-making. Inertia. Inertia is the resistance to any change in the current state of motion. The now common metaphor of a flywheel is often used to illustrate the power of inertia in business. Inertia gets the blame for waning product performance and competitiveness, feature fatigue, and poor innovation pipeline throughput. But it is also inertia that can keep the flywheel of growth spinning. Inertial slowing sets in when headcount grows, approval layers increase, and functional silos crop up. Without an effective system for consistently guiding new ideas from inception to launch, it's difficult to have a winning product development pipeline. As growth ramps up, it becomes increasingly difficult to keep or rekindle the entrepreneurial ethos of rapid cycle experimentation that was undoubtedly what allowed the company to find their product market fit in the first place. Friction. Friction occurs when moving parts rub against each other. It's a common cause of slow adoption speed, poor customer experience, retention, renewal difficulty, aka churn, and undelivered customer outcomes. Of course, not all friction is bad. Without the friction between the tires and the tarmac, a Formula One race car would be uncontrollable. The goal in business is to discover an optimal level of friction that produces a distinctive customer experience at a profit. The function of customer success, a post-sale concept attributed to SaaS pioneer Salesforce and introduced to tech companies over a decade ago, was developed to help reduce friction between a software company's products and the customer experience. If customers cannot pull value from your products quickly and effortlessly, friction will remain a difficult challenge. For friction to be minimized, you must understand the jobs your customers are trying to do and align the delivery of your products and services to their desired outcomes, supported by a clear roadmap to continually improve the customer user experience. Waste. Waste is performing work that not only adds no value, but detracts from it. It is perhaps the most prevalent impediment to value, not because the work being performed is inefficient, but rather because it is ineffective, defined as doing the wrong work. As Peter Drucker once rightly noted, there is surely nothing quite so useless as doing with great efficiency what should not be done at all. Scale-ups seem especially vulnerable to waste, often exhibiting all the usual symptoms, including key customer value-adding activities that are not linked to optimize quality, cost, speed, and experience. Critical information that fails to move effectively between functions and process users. Key process performance indicators that are opaque and out of date. Lack of a company-wide continuous process improvement capability. And senior leaders who are not actively involved in identifying, championing, and participating in process optimization. The effects of these forces are anything but metaphorical. Those who have ever struggled to understand their company strategy, been frustrated by their inability to implement new ideas, scratched their heads wondering why things are done the way they are, or had a bad experience as a customer, has felt the impact of these forces. They are real. They are the arch enemies of efficient scale and sustainable growth. But they are manageable. Our work together centers on helping companies eliminate these kinds of organizational impediments. Matt is fortunate to have spent nearly a decade inside the Toyota organization, learning to master continuous process improvement and the Toyota production system, known for its ability to achieve the maximum effect through minimum means, the underpinnings of which have become synonymous with lean thinking. Pablo has helped dozens of companies, including many well-known unicorns, build their revenue-generating machinery. Our partnership began over 10 years ago, and in nearly all the time since, we have focused on what some may consider a rather unconventional application of lean-based principles to the technology space. Most recently, to the go-to-market operations of subscription software scale-ups. That work has produced new insights and opened new pathways to performance that have universal relevance. Five Lean Scale-Up Principles. John Krafcik, the recently retired CEO of Google's Waymo division, first coined the term lean in a 1988 MIT Sloan Management Review article, culminating from his work as a researcher on an MIT-led global manufacturing study team. Kravchuk had been the first manufacturing engineer hired at the joint Toyota General Motors assembly plant in Fremont, California, called New United Motor Manufacturing, Inc., or NUMMI. Lean was his term to express what he believed to be the essence of the game-changing Toyota production system, a lack of waste in the system. The term came into management vogue with the 1996 bestseller Lean Thinking by James Womack and Daniel Jones, who led the MIT study during the previous decade. Lean has moved beyond the production environment to become an organizing principle that engages people in adding the highest possible value for customers across all operations. What makes Lean compelling and different as a management philosophy, however, is how that value is created. The process is essentially one of addition by subtraction, reducing or removing anything that unnecessarily impedes the free flow of customer-defined value. Amazon founder Jeff Bezos, a student and fan of the Toyota production system, called it working backwards, and the concept is now one of Amazon's leadership principles. While lean methods are the benchmark in manufacturing settings and have been applied with a modicum of success to entrepreneurial startups, broad application of lean methods, specifically to software scale-ups, remains limited. Our aspiration is to change that reality, because we have discovered that applying a broader interpretation of lean, one of balanced optimization, can be a powerful way to battle the momentum-stealing effects of drag, inertia, friction, and waste. By keeping a goal of balanced optimization front and center in our efforts to help tech firms scale for growth, we begin to see certain themes repeat. Those patterns evolved into a set of five guiding principles that, when adopted, made scale-up success much more likely. These principles form a framework for using lean-based operating principles that enable any company to effectively accelerate its scaling and growth. The model sits at the heart of our Lean Scale-Up program at Insight Partners. We've been trained as visual thinkers, so we like drawing models. And because five of anything is hard to remember, even if you do repeat it seven times, scale, S-C-A-L-E, offers a quick mnemonic. Strategic speed, constant experimentation, accelerated value, lean process, esprit de corps. At first listen, each of the individual principles in the scale framework might lead you to ask whether there is anything new here. That's a fair question. After all, there are no scholarly constructions, no sophisticated terminology. What is unique is the lean interpretation of the principle. Well-worn terms like strategy and value and experimentation take on new meanings when viewed through the lens of lean. The synergy created from integrating any one of the individual principles with the other four and using the collective model to scale efficiently and achieve sustainable growth by leveraging a lean mindset is unique. We have organized this book around the scale framework. Principle 1. Strategic speed. Fighter pilots, professional cyclists, and race car drivers know what geese flying in a V formation know. You can travel faster and farther with half the effort by drafting in the slipstreams created by those in front of you. The faster you go, the more energy you save. It's a virtuous cycle. And the more people in alignment, the bigger the slipstream, so you can go even faster. This is the simple physics of momentum, the equation for which is velocity, speed with direction, times mass. You can apply the concept to your company's strategies. We call it strategic speed, defined as the optimal speed for swift strategy deployment and decision-making. To create the organizational equivalent of slipstreams requires strategies, priorities, and objectives to be simultaneously linked vertically and horizontally. While every scale-up has an enterprise strategy and initial product-market fit, the unicorns seem to have discovered the power of company-wide alignment. Mechanisms like Japan's Hoshin Kanri, strategy deployment, and the younger but more well-known Western cousin OKRs, objectives and key results, implemented with tools and practices like the lean alignment practice of catchball, the business equivalent of the children's game of tossing a ball back and forth, help boost strategic speed. Scale-ups achieving company-wide alignment can expect to accelerate their growth over 30% more than those feeling the effects of misalignment-induced drag. Principle 2. Constant experimentation. Continuous innovation is a survival need and competitive must. Without innovation, inertia will govern speed. But innovation cannot be relegated to departments or reserved for the next-level killer app that may never materialize. It is tempting to put the responsibility on others, but instead, one must make simple, fast, frugal, and scalable experimentation an operating norm. As Netflix's co-founder and first CEO Mark Randolph wrote in his 2019 book, That Will Never Work, the key to being successful is not how good your ideas are, it's how good you are at being able to find quick, cheap, and easy ways to try your ideas. One of the big misperceptions about lean is that it's all about quality and cost. Those who have spent time embedded in the Toyota culture will delight in correcting you, letting you in on the fact that the Toyota production system was developed as a way to shorten the time from order to delivery and create a dash to cash without requiring the deep resources of the big U.S. automotive companies. The entire system evolved through a series of desperate experiments to scale up and grow revenue faster with less. Today, Toyota runs over 1 million experiments a year at all levels of the company. Some scholars maintain that continuous learning through rapid experimentation is the company's sole source of competitive advantage. Toyota was named the number one most admired auto company by Fortune in 2020 for the sixth consecutive year, and held the highest market share globally at 8.5% that same year. For high-velocity scale-ups, creating a steady stream of innovative new product and process concepts that consistently make it to market requires an equally fast, lightweight, high-impact method for constant experimentation, one that is unfortunately missing in most cases. Principle 3. Accelerated value. According to Matt Garman, Senior Vice President of Amazon Web Services, the single biggest obstacle to growth is a failure to understand and align with customers on their desired business outcomes. If left uncorrected, this failure can generate enough downstream friction to produce what every recurring revenue business dreads: customer attrition, aka churn. The tendency is to equate the concept of a customer or buyer journey with a sales funnel or consumption model coupled with a monolithic view of the customer, which is wrong. In other words, thinking customer equals account can lead to head-scratching when seemingly satisfied customers churn. At the root of the issue is the difficulty of thinking and operating horizontally in a vertical world. Customers are organized vertically, as are most company support functions, but the customer experience is horizontal. Rather than think like an NFL coach, sending plays in from the sideline to the quarterback, who then gives the command to execute, vertical, think like a Formula One pit crew, a team of over 20 with specific roles so tightly synchronized that they can mobilize on demand, stabilize the car, change the tires, make adjustments to the aerodynamics, and safely release the car to get back in the race in under 2 seconds. Enabling customers to realize value quickly promotes product adoption and positively impacts community spread and customer retention, renewal, and expansion. Ensuring that everyone in your company is aware of how to enable that value quickly in a unified fashion helps to accelerate your growth. According to a benchmarking study of over 1,350 companies in 80 countries by Qualtrics, over 80% cited customer experience as a competitive advantage, with benefits including increased customer loyalty and uplift in revenue. Principle 4. Lean process. Lean as a concept encourages simplicity as the path to speed. It holds that less is best, to make more room for what truly matters, and to eliminate what doesn't. It's a subtractive approach to continuously improving and simplifying even the most complicated workflows. It starts with clearly defined value, then systemically removing everything blocking the path to delivering it. It's a relentless endeavor, a different way of thinking, and it requires a mind shift. As the Little Prince author Antoine de Saint-Exupéry once noted, perfection is achieved not when there is nothing more to add, but when there is nothing left to take away. When juxtaposed with the endless nature of continuous improvement, this means that perfection is not a goal, but a vector. Companies in the scale-up stage are often fraught with waste simply because growth has outpaced development of standardized operational processes needed to sustain the business. Our work with dozens of scale-ups reveals that waste most often takes the form of performing work that no one, especially a customer, is asking for or needs. Targeting waste involves using a methodology over 80 years old, developed by the U.S. War Department in 1940, who coined the term continuous improvement. The aim was to convert the American manufacturing base to the war effort. Nearly 2 million personnel were trained during the five-year period, 1940 to 1945. It was then utilized to stabilize war-torn Japan under the leadership of General Douglas MacArthur during the seven-year U.S. occupation. Japan, having scarce resources other than human creative capital, termed it Kaizen, meaning change for better. With fast-moving tech scale-ups, an adapted method of traditional continuous improvement we call a Lean Kaizen Sprint works best. Our Lean Kaizen Sprints, conducted both in person as well as remotely, produce an average improvement in quality, cost, speed, and customer experience of roughly 25%. Principle 5. Esprit de corps. You can't build a Formula One car by yourself, nor a company, especially not a unicorn. It takes an experienced team and leaders to create the kind of environment that enables the first four operating principles to come to life. Enter the notion of esprit de corps. French for team spirit, and the last of Henri Fayol's 14 principles of management, esprit de corps figures centrally in military and paramilitary organizations, which are notorious for being results-oriented when it comes to leadership. Mission first, people always, is the mantra. But a peek at how military organizations actually build leadership skills reveals that establishing a culture of esprit de corps is by taking a people-first, mission-always approach. Research by UCLA social psychologist Matthew Lieberman supports this view. In a study examining social skills and leadership behaviors, those viewed as having a predominant results focus have only a 1 in 7 chance of being viewed as great leaders, while those viewed as having a predominant social or empathic focus have about the same or slightly less chance. But for those strong in both results and social skills, the likelihood of being seen as a great leader is 5 times greater. This is consistent with what NASA's Jet Propulsion Lab leader Brian Muirhead refers to as a grease and glue model of leadership. Muirhead's team built and landed the Pathfinder rover on Mars more quickly and for less than it cost Hollywood to produce the blockbuster movie Titanic. Grease and glue leaders understand that establishing a people-culture fit is every bit as important as a product-market fit when it comes to scaling for growth. Your star product requires a team of star players to advance it to market and capture maximum value. So much so that Netflix is happy to advertise to all job seekers that they will pay an ill-fitting employee an industry-leading severance of 4 months' pay while they search for a star replacement. Like any set of traits purporting to describe the differentiating attributes of star players, athletes, artists, unicorns, one does not need all of them in equal measure, nor can having all of them guarantee ultimate success. But we believe that having some degree of each trait, tailored to your specific situation, can certainly help your odds. Just how to find the right mix is what a unicorn knows. Our great hope is that what a unicorn knows delivers a useful and applicable blend of insight, inspiration, and implementation that enables you to chart your company's path to unicornship and beyond. Principle 1. Strategic speed. Speed is the ultimate weapon in business. All else being equal, the fastest company in any market will win. Dave Girard, founder and CEO, Upstart. In the final four laps of the 55-lap 2021 Formula One Russian Grand Prix, the McLaren team's 21-year-old Lando Norris could taste his very first victory. He had secured the pole position in qualifying the day before against the best of the best, including the greatest of all time, Lewis Hamilton of Mercedes. Race day looked like a repeat performance. Hamilton was mere seconds behind Norris, but conditions were changing rapidly. Clouds that had been threatening rain all day moved in from the Black Sea, and a light drizzle began to fall on parts of the track. Wasting no time, Mercedes race director immediately ordered Hamilton to box, meaning take a pit stop for intermediate rain tires. The choice was a calculated risk. If the rain stopped, Norris was a lock to win. If it continued, any drivers running dry tires became vulnerable, a danger to themselves. With uncertainty looming large, the McLaren race strategy was under pressure. The choices they had to make, while no different from the choices involved in any other race strategy, now became overwhelming with a win on the line. Can we hold the lead with the tires we have? Do we risk our lead by taking a 30-second pit stop with so few laps to go? We have two rain tire compounds. Which is best? Will rain tires drag too much on the dry parts of the track? Norris and McLaren waited. The rain continued. Lando's car looked like Bambi on ice, and Lewis Hamilton won his history-making 100th Grand Prix. Norris finished a distant 7th. When it comes to strategy, it turns out that speed matters. Speed matters. A company looking to efficiently scale for sustainable growth must treat speed as the dominant priority. Speed to market, speed in market, speed to value, and, if backed by private investment, speed to exit. Scale-ups are unique from younger startups and more mature grown-ups in this regard. Newer startups are generally fast by nature because they have little to bog them down. Investors, employees, bureaucracy, facilities, processes. An overwhelming sense of uncertainty and of risk feeds a fear of failure that fuels startups to move fast to find a product, market fit, and viable business model. More mature grown-ups on the other end of the spectrum are more focused on deliberate, measured, predictable growth that yields healthy profits and pleases shareholders. Having much to lose feeds an altogether different kind of fear, one that produces drag and slows the company down. Scale-ups occupy the challenging middle ground, which often results in a sort of bipolar organizational tension where half the company is still in run-and-gun startup mode, while the other half, usually hired in senior executives from larger established firms, operates in a more slow and steady grown-up mode. Speed is the essence of Peter Drucker's first of four entrepreneurial strategies outlined in his now classic and still relevant book, Innovation and Entrepreneurship, Fustest with the Mostest. Drucker attributed the wording to a Civil War general describing his secret to success. Dave Girard, best known for building Google's enterprise apps division into a $1 billion-plus global business, concurs. Now the CEO of a fintech scale-up, Upstart, Girard firmly believes that this is the age of billion-dollar startups, where the best and brightest companies compete at a breakneck speed. Today, the fastest win, as long as the organization keeps speed, efficiency, and innovation as a core foundation. Organization speed defines the company's ability to seize opportunities, act against external threats, innovate, expand to new markets, learn quickly, and hire and retain talented people that thrive in a fast-paced environment. Speed is indeed a key determinant of success. Yet it is certainly not without risk, as Drucker pointed out. Being fustest with the mostest is very much like a moonshot, he wrote. A deviation of a fraction of a minute from the arc, and the missile disappears into outer space. In other words, the margin of error isn't very wide. Be that as it may, every downhill mountain biker knows that speed is your friend when attempting to conquer a difficult descent. As unnatural and counterintuitive as it seems, Carrying speed is the only way to maintain control, increase stability, and minimize risk of injury from a fall. Losing momentum by going too slowly or overbraking is a surefire way to lose your balance, fall over, or go over the handlebars, just as going too fast for your skill and capability is. And to carry the Formula One analogy a bit further, consider for a moment an entire F1 organization in which speed is the de facto currency. The whole enterprise is aligned around speed, from the huge investments by corporate sponsors to the executive boardroom, to the enormously sophisticated technology of the car, to the race strategy and control team, to the driver, and all the way down to the pit crew who perform their work in under 3 seconds. Cars travel at average speeds greater than the takeoff velocity of an aircraft, often exceeding 200 miles an hour in certain zones. Yet it can literally all go up in smoke on the track in the blink of an eye, and has. Enter the need for finding your strategic speed, defined as the optimal executional velocity achieved through company-wide alignment of strategies and objectives that reduces drag as well as risk. In nearly every business activity imaginable, your strategic speed will depend on how well difficult strategic decisions and critical choices are made and acted upon. The late Colonel John Boyd, a United States Air Force fighter pilot and renowned military strategist, codified this concept in what he termed an OODA loop: observe, orient, decide, act. Not coincidentally, Boyd was also a student of the Toyota production system, which incorporates a similar loop for carrying out continuous improvement, known as the Schuhart or PDCA cycle: plan, do, check, act. While the terms in an OODA loop are simple enough, the context in which they are implemented is most relevant. In an aerial dogfight, the pilot who executes this rapid, iterative cycle fastest wins, because he is operating inside the opponent's own OODA loop. This disorients and confuses adversaries, which puts them at a significant disadvantage. The OODA loop concept has been broadly applied not only to tactical combat situations, but to military campaign operations and processes in general, as well as to legal litigation, law enforcement, firefighting, other types of rapid response operations, and, of course, business strategy. The concept of strategic speed in the context of an entrepreneurial company, leveraging lean simplicity to generate and go to market with a winning strategy, captures the spirit of rapid iteration represented by the OODA loop. While strategy and speed have traditionally been somewhat at odds with each other, the goal of strategic speed is to rethink and resolve problems with that relationship. Rather than offer a comprehensive treatise on strategy, we offer insight into how strategy viewed in a leaner, simpler light can help your company boost its velocity, as Dave Girard referred to it, by reducing the forces of drag. Drag is nearly always related to a lack of alignment among the various entities involved in strategy and decision-making. A leaner view of strategy. Strategy means different things to different people. There are probably as many definitions of strategy as there are those claiming to be strategists. It's surprising how many companies will trounce out something other than a true strategy when asked to provide theirs, producing instead a wide variety of materials masquerading as strategy: mission or vision or values documents, financial plans and forecasts, customer segmentations and personas, marketing plans, and collections of borrowed best practices. Some executives seem to think that their company is too small to have to worry about strategy, mistaken in the belief that strategy is somehow a function of size, not discipline. There are even those, never market leaders, mind you, who believe that strategy is a waste of time because defensible competitive advantage is fleeting and unsustainable, especially in times of great uncertainty and rapid change. Another common lament, heard among senior executives, is that strategy is necessary and important, but it's complicated, takes too long, and all too often yields mixed results. These executives would rather ride the wave of rapid growth as long as they can, forgetting that all waves crest. As a result, They tend to default to actions centered on simply exploiting and optimizing what brought them initial success in terms of their product market fit and business model. That may be fine for some, but it isn't strategy, and it seldom, if ever, leads to the kind of market dominance worthy of a unicorn. Old school strategy. The fact that strategy alienates and confounds many leaders is entirely understandable. What's surprising is how many senior executives still labor under an outdated, linear, calendar-based, and situationally irrelevant paradigm of strategy, undoubtedly learned years ago in business school, which goes something like this: analyze, plan, execute. Rinse and repeat every January. Here's how it generally works. Somewhere around the calendar year transition, a need for strategy magically appears on the company agenda, irrespective of whether a new strategy is actually needed. Someone higher up in the company assigns this year's strategy to someone, or someones, usually much lower down in the organization, often a young MBA or a team of them. Step one is to conduct an analysis. The most common form of which was taught to our young MBAs while in business school is SWOT: strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. SWOT remains the dominant way to begin strategy efforts. And it all sounds so legit. I'm on the SWOT team. It's a great acronym. It sounds like SWOT, Special Weapons and Tactics, which is sticky. Curiously, no one knows who actually came up with SWOT. To unpack SWOT, you start with the S, for strengths, a concept loaded with silent pretext. All strengths are relative, meaning no single strength remains a strength in all contexts. A strength in one situation can be a weakness in another context. The same holds true for the other elements of SWOT. There is no such thing as a universal weakness, opportunity, or threat. Therefore, our gallant MBAs must make some situational assumptions in order to know what to pay attention to and what to ignore, because one cannot perform a SWOT analysis of everything. It would take a century and a few million pages. To make the job manageable and easier, our SWOTers generally just adopt the assumptions under which the old strategy was formed, which explains why most new strategies end up looking a lot like the old ones, albeit with some new numbers, dates, and names. But hey, step one is done. Zendesk's chief technology officer Adrian McDermott shared the Zendesk version of this situation on the Saster official podcast. In 2015, we have an edict from on high that we're going to be a $1 billion business by 2020. We're looking at the plans of our actual book of business. We are preparing for an all-company event. Most of the company is going to Whistler in Canada for a sales kickoff, which is a company kickoff we're launching. It's a big deal. We're already a public company at this point, so we're living our lives in public. We have an upmarket business. We have a repeatable transaction business in SMB, or small business, and we look at the actual book of business, and we look at the emerging products that we have, and some, you know, strategy guy, newly minted MBA from Harvard Business School, comes in. He runs a Monte Carlo analysis, 1,000 scenarios, and figures out what are the most likely ways that we get to a billion. And the clear conclusion is that we need to keep launching products, and we need some of those products to grow, add on, expand the TAM, increase ACV with customers, all the things you would expect us to do, right? What's interesting as I look back at this analysis is that it was complete bollocks. It was actually wildly wrong and incorrect. The second step is the plan. Now, the word strategy is often used in adjective form with planning, that is, strategic planning, a phrase that has unfortunately and incorrectly become synonymous with strategy, calling to mind a process that is perceived by many as that rather laborious annual chore to produce a thick and weighty multi-year document that captures all the amazing things you're going to do in the coming months or years, along with budgets, assignments, and timetables. Executing the plan is, of course, the last step. But, as Michael Porter told us 30 years ago in his definitive book, Competitive Strategy, in order to prevail against others in a given space, you must consciously choose to do some things and not do others. Having a plan is all well and good, and can certainly be complementary to strategy, but it isn't the point of strategy. The reason strategy even matters at all is that resources are quite simply finite, and we can't possibly do everything we might like to do. The intent behind strategy is to force often difficult choices and make very clear, specific statements about what you are and, perhaps more importantly, aren't going to do, and why or why not, in order to maximize the use of those finite resources and increase the odds of success. While one might reasonably argue that a plan does this, the reality is that although they may imply some of those choices, most strategic plans are not explicit about them. This explains why most plans get such mixed results, and why some senior leaders often take a rather dim view of strategy. New School Strategy.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.